Hello, my name is Terry Dean, and this is another edition of Solon Speaks. Our featured guest today is Ed Krause, who is our council representative from Ward 6. Ed, as always, it's a joy to have you come and, you know, be part of our show. We don't get to do this often enough, so we need to update the people and, you know, see what's going on.
Absolutely.
Before we get started, I just want to learn a little bit about your family. We were talking earlier that, you know, when we started this many years ago, we were talking about your family being like, you know, 4 and 6 years old, and now they're, how old are they now?
Well, they are 18 and 16, my two daughters, mm-hmm. And my son is 10, so things have changed. Dramatically.
Certainly driver's licenses and thinking about college and all those kind of things are
Everything.
Starting to come into play.
Yeah, yeah.
Aren't you glad they got older and not us?
Yeah, it's funny how it happens that way.
Yeah, I agree. My kids are the same way. I understand completely. You know, one of the things that that I know you like to get into, do you have any hobbies? I know one of the hobbies that I saw you get involved in is photography. How'd you get into that? Because it's one of the things I really enjoy.
I do, and I started when I was a kid, mm-hmm. when we used to take trips various mm-hmm. places, and, you know, my parents got me one of those little Kodak Instamatics, and mm-hmm. I just started taking pictures, and I had a love for, just nature and animals, mm-hmm. and you know, various things, and then I like taking pictures of buildings and cities, and so it just developed over time, and I would always take pictures, get them developed, put my pictures in an album, so now I have probably 80 or 90 different photo albums.
Wow.
Of just, you know, throughout my life, and a few years ago, when the Art Center started promoting a focus contest mm-hmm. That we have every year, we do it, I think KeyBank sponsors it, and we do it mm-hmm. in conjunction with some other communities, I entered few pictures, and I got some honorable mentions.
Oh, good.
So it was the first time I ever, you know, entered any of my pictures. I decided I was just going to blow them up, put them in a frame, and see if it worked. So it's, it's a love of mine, and it's something I can't draw, and I can't do some, I'm not, you know, great at music, but photography really was something that I was attracted to because you know it's something you do and then you could see the end result
mm-hmm, yeah.
of your of your project and it lasts hopefully a lifetime
mm-hmm. and it certainly is an art form. I finally broke down a couple years ago.
You know?
And bought a digital camera. I was like holding out with my film for all those years because I could develop it and so forth. But I finally broke down and bought a digital camera. Really enjoy it, so I'm having a good time with that.
Well, you'd be proud of me because I still have my Nikon N80.
I still have my film camera that
I like to shoot with. And mm-hmm. thank Dodd's Camera Shop for still having film
yes.
and still being able to process the film. Mm-hmm. So I thank them. And actually Walgreens does as well. So
good. All right. So I'm glad to hear that's a great hobby for you. I've also
you.
Enjoyed it.
Thank you.
What are some of the committees that you serve on with within the city? Before we'll talk about Ward 6
sure,
in a minute.
Sure,
but what's
sure.
the overall picture? People think that you know, you just meet every couple of weeks and you're done.
The two principal committees are safety. I've been on safety, I think, since I got on council,
mm-hmm.
And it's we combine ours. It's safety and public properties.
Mm-hmm.
So we deal with all of our public buildings, plus in addition to all the safety forces and all the issues surrounding the safety forces, and then the enterprise zone,
mm-hmm.
which is a real love of mine. Because it really deals with the business community.
Mm-hmm.
We have a tremendous amount of interaction with the business community, and our Enterprise Zone Committee, unlike others in other communities, we partner with the schools and, mm-hmm. and the school board and the superintendent. So in all of our meetings, we generally have a consensus of three council members, the mayor, and the school board.
Okay.
So it's a wonderful opportunity to collaborate, and because we both have, obviously, a major interest in seeing new development, new businesses, you know, expansion of businesses, and we provide an array of incentives
mm-hmm.
To make sure that a business will locate here or stay here.
Great. And one of the things you talked about, safety, you said that that's partially handles the safety of the city, the fire department, the police department, and so forth. I mean, I've always found our safety forces to be second to none. They're excellent. Are we keeping an excellent safety force in place right now?
Yeah, I mean, I think at the end of the day, you know, I think as a council representative, I think you have a lot of responsibilities
mm-hmm.
in terms of, you know, the planning issues, the infrastructure issues. I mean, we have a lot going on, the business issues, but I've always felt that priority number one, on my agenda always is safety. Because if you don't have a safe community, if you don't have good response times with fire, if you don't have good help in emergency medical services to help people, if you don't have a well-trained police force that's around and very proactive, it affects your entire community.
Yes, I would agree.
People lose confidence, and you can see that in other communities. So I always felt our top priority is the safety, security of our residential areas, make people feel safe while they're in their neighborhoods, in their homes. But equally important is the safety and security in our industrial and commercial areas. Mm-hmm. And that's where something I think we do much better than anyone else. Is our police have a daily interaction, and our fire department has daily interactions with our business community. Mm-hmm. And the communication, the response times are second to none.
Okay, well, that sounds good, and it sounds like obviously we're keeping that, I'll call it a business model, in place, so that sounds good.
And technology plays a crucial role. That's where I think we've really changed the relationship with our safety forces to the community, is the technology we use in terms of both police and fire.
All right. Sounds good. Let's talk a little bit. Let's get back over to Ward 6. We were talking previously about Briar Hill, the famous Briar Hill Dam. And I was kind of kidding you that it goes back 20 years, and you said, I think it goes back 50 years. I think people have sat on council and got off council and died in the project, you know, never really got finished. It sounds to me like the project is finished. Can you give us is this like the final, the update? Are we done? Are people using Briar Hill as a recreational facility, plus, you know, obviously stormwater management? How did that all turn out?
Yeah. Well, just to give you, you know, everyone out there, just a little snippet. You know, this was a unique, I would say, public-private partnership, mm-hmm. Where the city really contributed about two-thirds of the project, and the residents, through a multi-year assessment, about one-third of the cost, and that will be through tax assessments. Mm-hmm. We reconstructed the entire dam on the, I would say, the the southeastern edge of the dam by placing what's called an inflatable gate, mm-hmm. an inflatable bladder, mm-hmm. so that if there ever was, God forbid, a 100-year storm, that we can lift the gate up, the water can flow out of through the dam, and not make its way into Carriage Park, and not make its way to other parts of the community. The gate, the bladder, is up and running. Mm-hmm. I was there last week. It looks wonderful. The project really turned out great. Mr. Excavator was the contractor on it. The lake was lowered quite a bit. The folks in Briar Hill, there's about 75 homes that reside in Briar Hill. They've been able to use the lake recreational all year. Mm-hmm. While the project is finishing up, we've actually done most of the landscaping, finished up the landscaping there, mm-hmm. and but most importantly, from the city's perspective, and the reason why the city got involved, is we have close to 300 homes that are north of Briar Hill, Ledge mm-hmm. Hill, Springside, Cannon Road, that drain into Briar Hill Lake. So now we have really a permanent area where those homes can drain mm-hmm. Any stormwater from those properties, and that's sort of Ledge Hill and Briar and Springside sit on a hill, mm-hmm. so it really flows.
Water runs downhill, that's
from,
for sure.
From those communities, and it goes right into the lake. And so it really, it's a sort of a unique public-private partnership. They get their lake, they get the recreational facilities, and it does add tremendous amount of property values mm-hmm. To that lake community and the surrounding areas, and we get our most critical stormwater detention and mm-hmm. stormwater management. It's a big part of our stormwater management system in the city.
Okay. The only funny part of the whole thing is they get the dam finished, and now we have the least amount of rainfall.
You know, that's so okay. We'll take it, because sooner or later there will be a storm.
Absolutely, and it offsets those years when we had a lot of rain, and, you know, their stormwater project had to get going.
Absolutely.
So it's good. It's very nice to hear finally that the project is pretty much wrapped up and working like it's supposed to, and it sounds like a great effort between the community and the people who live there in that community and the city of Solon. And it's green, too. Everybody got to use it and enjoy it, so that,
you know,
that works
out nicely. It really, and years ago, we teetered on the edge because there was a point in time where I thought maybe we wouldn't have the lake anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think people realize it's part of Solon's history. It's one of the first things that were developed was the Briar Hill Lake as a result of the railroad, you know. And so it's one of our unique features in our community. I happen to think it's a jewel.
Mm-hmm.
I also think Sherbrooke Lake is a jewel as well. And those, you know, those are few and far between.
And I agree.
Yeah.
A couple other things going on in your ward. Bainbridge Road has been going for the last couple of years, and I think that transverses actually a couple of wards.
Yes.
That project looks like it's coming to an end. Is it coming to an end? Can we, can we shoot the fireworks off and say it's finished?
It is. I mean, it is. There are, throughout the spring and early summer, as you know, that's a county project, and DeGioia was the construction manager on the project, and obviously we're a partner, you know, in the project. So they've done several walkthroughs.
Mm-hmm.
And the walkthroughs really are just make sure everything is complete, the restoration. My only, probably if I had just some only regrets of the project were we did have to take down quite a few trees.
Mm-hmm.
As you know, Bainbridge Road had a lot of trees. Mm-hmm. You had to take some down because they were right in the middle of the right of way to provide for the sidewalks and the bike lanes and various things. But I think if I look back overall, I think it worked out very well.
Mm-hmm.
I think the contractor did a great job. They worked hard and they worked long hours.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the residents appreciated the fact that these guys were out there working at all times. And it's nice to see not so much the cars, because we're going to get a lot of cars, because when you have a new road, a nice new road.
Mm-hmm.
But I really enjoyed seeing residents use the sidewalks, being able to walk now on Bainbridge Road, because it was not safe, really. To be able to walk, even if you were trying to go to a neighbor's house, you know, four or five doors down, now you can safely walk. The kids ride their bikes all throughout Bainbridge Road, through the subdivisions and on the street. I see people, running, all throughout there. So it really it ties into everything I think that we're trying to do with the whole Healthy Solon initiative. Is create those spaces. I mean, you can't be a healthy community unless you create spaces for people to walk, to bike, to run, to do whatever, but just to make sure people are living active, lives like that. Because, years ago, everything was built just for the car.
That's true.
I think cities where we developed Solon probably 50, 60 years ago, it was developed for cars.
Mm-hmm.
It was not developed for pedestrians.
Correct.
To be able to walk anywhere, or certainly for bicycles, or for anything like that. And I think we've changed.
Mm-hmm.
I think what we've seen was you're always going to provide for cars, because obviously people need to get to work and get, to take their kids places and get to the ball fields. But I think in conjunction with that, we have to be smarter to make sure that we're promoting active and healthy lifestyles, because I think that's going to be the next wave of planning. If I have to say, this 21st century is planning for people as opposed to just automobiles.
And the other thing on Bainbridge Road, they are putting the trees back.
They are. There is going to be a tremendous amount of restoration.
Yes. So that's going on, and it'll take a little time for the trees to grow, but they will. And it'll be, obviously it'll continue to be an attractive street.
I have to say that the residents of the street, it's a difficult when it's on your street.
Sure.
And they're taking your property, and a lot of your beautiful mature trees are down. It's a difficult time. I mean, they went through 2.5 years of this.
Mm-hmm.
So I have to say they've been real troopers, the folks all up and down Bainbridge Road, and obviously off Bainbridge Road as well, because they had to find alternative roads to be able to go to and fro. So those people really deserve, they had a lot of patience throughout this project. And I think they appreciate the fact now that they have a beautiful road.
Yeah. They have a good, they certainly have a good improvement.
Absolutely.
We should just remind folks, though, that it's a nice new road, but please follow the speed limits. It's not an access road to speed on. It's a residential street.
Absolutely.
So. What else is going on as far as other road projects? We have an infrastructure fund in the city that a certain amount of money is put into. I believe it's 0.5% of the income tax. And then that money is used to improve various roads and infrastructure things in the city. Has the engineering department gone around the city now and looked at various roads and say, okay, we need to repair this one and we got to fix this one? What's the update on that?
Well, you know, I think if you look at what we've done, Pettibone and Bainbridge are the models.
Mm-hmm.
Anything we do, you know, going into the future, they're going to look like Pettibone and Bainbridge. Mm-hmm. They're probably going to have sidewalks and bike lanes. And so, sure, I mean, there's always, you know, what does the future hold? There's Liberty Road is something that we will eventually take a look at.
Mm-hmm.
It's an old road. It's heavily used. It's probably going to be in need of updates and improvements. People love to walk mm-hmm. and run and bike on that road as well, but it's not as safe as, say, Bainbridge and Pettibone. So we'll certainly take a look at Liberty. Harper's another road that gets a decent amount of use without any sidewalks, so certainly we're going to look at. But those are things, you know, we're starting to really take a look at. And we'll always, you know, look at the smaller projects, you know, streets. We've done, mm-hmm. you know, a lot of streets throughout the community. We've done streets, both residential streets, mm-hmm. As well as in the industrial and in the business sense. So, and then in conjunction with that, we're always updating, you know, our infrastructure and stormwater management. We continue to goes back 6 years ago mm-hmm. with the major flood, test the inflow and infiltration of our sanitary and our storm system. We do dye testing now regularly. I tend to think of it as sort of a floodplain mm-hmm. where the major damage took place in areas, you know, like the ABCs and the mm-hmm. Preserve and off of Bainbridge Road all the way down to Liberty Hill mm-hmm. in those areas to make mm-hmm. sure that we find any of infiltration. We clean it out, we mm-hmm. televise these, and we do the dye testing to make sure that it's clean, and we're going to do this regularly. I mean, okay. this is something it's an ongoing. This is not something we're going to put off and say, oh, we'll do it another 20 years.
Yeah.
These are regular maintenance preventive, because I think in 06 we looked at it as more reactive.
Mm-hmm.
We certainly reacted to our system was broken down. I think now we've gone in the mode of being a lot more proactive in terms of our stormwater system. And my philosophy is you need to invest.
Yes.
You can't just let these this system go for many, many years without investment, because unless you invest in your system, the system will break down.
Right.
And it's worth the investment.
And it's part of the infrastructure of the city that makes the whole thing run, and so it has to be done. So the important thing, as you pointed out, is this will continue to be a maintenance item, and
absolutely
every day it gets focused. Let's talk also a little bit about what's going on around the city. There's all of a sudden, I don't want to say things came alive, but it seems the economy picked up and things are looking a little better. Certainly the first thing I'd like to ask you is, well, how are the finances of the city? Are we paying our bills? How are we doing on that? Are we getting a good income revenue?
We are. Obviously, we're blessed with a vibrant business community,
mm-hmm.
And it's something that we take great pride in. We have close relationships with all of our businesses. Peggy Weil-Dorfman does an absolute incredible job.
Yes, she does.
Keeping tabs of not just what's going on in Solon, but what's going on in Northeastern Ohio mm-hmm. in terms of who's moving where, who's looking at what buildings are available, how much space do you need?
Mm-hmm.
What's your projections over the next, you know, 3, 5, you know, 7 years in terms of, you know, adding employees and adding growth? So these are something that we always, you know, look at. I mean, we're, you know, the reality of it is the last 5 years are tough times.
Yes.
And we've made it through well mm-hmm. Compared to other communities, but that doesn't mean we can just rest
yes.
and say, oh, we're Solon and we're doing
we're
great.
We're fine, yeah, no. Everything's good, right?
No. Even Solon has to be very careful
mm-hmm.
in everything we do. And I think in terms of our financial management, and we did this with Bill Weber, and certainly we're doing this now with Dennis Kennedy, our new finance director. It's not new anymore, Dennis. Mm-hmm. It's been there a while. Mm-hmm. We take a very fiscally conservative approach to our finances, whether it's in terms of our investments, the way we view our budgeting every year. because we want to make sure that not only do we provide for the community, provide for all of our various departments, but we have money left over, and we make sure that we have a continuum to make sure that we're fiscally sound, not just in 2012, but for many years to come, and for future generations that are going to be involved in Solon.
And certainly that makes sense. One of the things that's being talked about in the newspapers right now is Cuyahoga County is going around and reevaluating property taxes. And I believe I read in the newspaper the other day, it could, you know, some communities got knocked by like 33%. I think, I'm not sure this is an exact number, but I think Solon said it went, our property values were down by like 3%. Does that have a significant impact to the dollars and money coming into our community?
Yeah, I wouldn't say it has a significant impact. Out of the property taxes that are paid, the majority of the property taxes are paid to the schools from your property taxes from your home. About 20% goes to the county through the the county budget, and then what's left over comes to us. It's usually 5-7% in that general range. So it's not what we rely on year after year. Obviously, we rely on our income tax collections more than our property taxes. Does it help? Sure.
Do we turn the money down.
Do we make every effort to maintain it? Absolutely. I mean, do we monitor both in terms of the aesthetics of the neighborhoods, how the homes are looking? Joyce Soltis, who is our inspector, goes out every day, obviously looking to make sure that our properties are in good shape, that people are taking care of any violations that may take place. Our housing stack, I think, is still very good. I think it's still very sound. The majority of our houses are owner-occupied. We haven't fallen into the trap that a lot of communities have fallen into, where the majority of their homes are rentals, as opposed to owner-occupied. Very few rentals in our residential areas, and I think that's a good thing, because I think you wanna keep your owner-occupied status at very high throughout the community.
Yeah, when you drive down the street on trash day and you kind of look at what's on the lawn, you realize that people are keeping their properties up, and that's very important. And I hope it continues that way.
And we instituted an inspection review about, well, it started at the beginning of the year, and it's going very well. It's our building department does the inspections, and we inspect all rental properties in terms, could be the large units, or it could be just a house that's a rental. We try not to be too invasive. We try to make sure that it's just done, and we really directed this to make sure it's just for safety, just to make sure that it's safe for the tenant and any concerns that a landlord may have, because sometimes the landlord is in town and sometimes they're out of town. So you don't know. So that's I looked at that as a good thing, and we kept the cost relatively low compared to other communities. But I do think it's important to make sure that even rental properties are kept up in the same manner as someone who's living in in their owner-occupied property.
Certainly goes to the quality of the community. That's for sure. Certainly one of the other big projects that finally got off the ground is, I guess, I don't know if you want to call it the Giant Eagle Plaza, but I think it has technically has a new name. It seems that once the Perlick Kaplan family sold it to the new developer, to the new owner, it was like the next day the bulldozer was in the parking lot and they started working. How's that one coming along? I mean, all the plans have been submitted. I mean, the drawings are good. There's going to be stuff there. We were speaking of a photography. I just happened to be in Dodd Camera, and they said, "Yeah, we're moving to the other end of the plaza." So we can still buy film. That's good.
Absolutely.
And what's going on with that one? When do they see like that being finished? I mean, that's a big project.
Terry, this is not unlike Briar Hill. This is something that's been going on for a long, long time, and. While now those of us that are sitting up there are getting the credit, there's a lot of people before us that did a lot of groundwork, former mayors, former council members that really worked hard to make sure that this particular property was redeveloped. We've had various scenarios. Bob Stark came in with a development project 6 years ago. That didn't work, and obviously in 2008 the credit market crashed. Banks were not loaning money anymore. But we, throughout the years, have really been prodding Perlick & Kaplan to redevelop. They really were not developers. They needed help with development, and it was fortuitous that Echo Real Estate came in, because they're the real estate group affiliated with Giant Eagle.
Correct,
they're out of
yes.
Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and they really saw an opportunity. The property became for sale. They worked out a deal with the Perlick Kaplan families. It's a large family. They had to get a sign off.
There's a lot of people involved in that one. I remember
many people throughout the country. But we all worked hard to make sure that we have a new development. Echo Real Estate is a professional development team. They are nationally known for on time, on budget. Good, you know, projects, very, you know, beautiful architecture, and they had to go through our process, and Rob Franklin, director of planning, made sure that they're using Western Reserve architecture. You're going to see a really nice, beautiful, new store, about 92,000 square feet. It's going to be a market, a bistro, so you're going to have all the amenities you're going to ever ask for. I call it the Taj Mahal of Giant Eagle. It'll probably be the nicest Giant Eagle you'll ever see. They're going to have some nice out parcels with some tenants. They're going to have two principal out parcels. One out parcel is where the old Medic used to be. They're redoing that part of the existing stores over there, and then they're building a new out parcel just to the north of that, which will have other tenants, some of the existing tenants at the plaza now. They're going to bring in some new tenants. So you're going to have two nice new out parcels. You'll have a new Get-Go building, which is going to be next to the Sprint store. We have added more green space to the project, so you'll see it's going to be quite attractive, the way that everything is going to be situated. We want to make sure that people have a good experience, you know, a pleasant experience. So you're not just going to Giant Eagle to shop, but maybe you're going to the coffee shop or hopefully a restaurant and various other amenities that are going to be in there. Carrington Court, which is the senior housing just to the south, we want to make sure that those folks can walk over and be able to shop and use, you know, all the
amenities in there.
So it really, and also it helps our stormwater management, so that there's not so much impervious surface, because the way you did shopping centers 60 years ago, it was just flat asphalt, and it was not, we realized it was not great for stormwater management. So this is a much better designed system, less impervious surface, more use of stormwater management techniques throughout, more green space, and have the ability to hold the water as opposed to letting it, run off the property.
More flowers and landscaping and so forth.
Absolutely. So this is just the start. I mean, I think that what this is showing is that the economy is starting to come back a little bit. I think banks, they're not giving money away. I think they're starting to think in long term that there are some nice projects going on, and they need to, be able to open up for good projects.
And
when you have a professional developer like this, who they know is going to provide a great project, and is financially sound, I think banks are starting to look at. And so this is a start. We're obviously going to look at other sites, such as the Sears Mark site. That's that's obviously probably the top destination for developer to look at, because it's a contained site there. It's a gateway into the community. You can do a nice, almost like a where they, like an Eaton style, where they have on Chagrin. That would be a prime space, and what really sells and really drives that property, its proximity to 422, so that you can get in and out from there. So these are things we look at it as the first step, and opportunities to spur other opportunities and other development. I mean, we've had some new restaurants come into town. Burntwood Tavern certainly opened up just a couple weeks ago.
Right,
and if you've ever
really
driven by there, it's crowded. They did a wonderful job of renovating the old Max and Irma site. All the various techniques and designs that they have, both exterior and interior, are really going to be attractive. I mean, the new Harvest location on Bainbridge, where the old Arabica store restaurant was. Joey's opened up down by Miles and Brainerd.
That's right.
And that's a nice new attractive restaurant. So we've had some nice nice new restaurants that came into town. And additionally, while this spurs the development, we've had I think some nice new applications for our GRIP program, which is very active, which is the Growth Revitalization and Industrialization Program, where we take older buildings and provide incentives for someone to come in to redevelop them and to gentrify some of the old, the historic areas and things like that. Perfect example on Solon Road, Donna Heffernan opened up an accounting office there right on Solon Road, an old house that she is redeveloping. So things like that really help in those areas, because they provide incentives for other people to come on in and take a look. Could be could be an office space, that's what lends itself to some of the old buildings. And then obviously our job creation grant program, which is the real mainstay of our enterprise zone, has been very active. We've had companies come in both in Solon that have looked to stay in Solon and expand. They want some new space, and we've been able to provide those opportunities, and companies out of Solon that have looked at, they want to maybe buy a building, redo warehouse space, add employees, looking at the proximity to the schools and the highway. So we've had a lot of activity in our job creation grant program over the last year or two.
So Solon continues to be an attractive place to bring people to do business, and it's a business-friendly community, so that continues. And I think the last time we talked a while back, it was, I believe we were like 94% occupied on our business business property, so that's very good. A lot of communities would like to have 94% occupancy, that's for sure. So
sometimes people get a false sense, because they'll look at the shopping centers, and there's some, obviously, retail is tough. It's a tough business, but that does not reflect the overall vacancy rate of the commercial areas, the industrial areas. Our vacancy rate is low in terms of national average in the industrial commercial areas, yes.
Let's take a minute and talk a couple of things, the fun things of summer. I was driving down 91, and I've often said that when I look over in the park and I see, a couple million people, I don't know how many, and they're all playing baseball and using the swing set, and they're doing stuff. And I think that's just wonderful that we have a place, as you said early, regarding healthy Solon and people going out and walking and doing those kind of things. We can enjoy our community, and I think that's a huge asset to Northeast Ohio. For example, things are coming up like Home Days are coming up, and the car cruise, which is certainly one of my favorite things. The Arts Center. The Arts Center seems this year, they seem to be doing something every day. I mean, they're having a great, Karen Prasser must be having a great old time over there. What's going on with the Arts Center, for example? It's about 10 years now, isn't it?
You know, it's interesting. When we meet with, particularly when we talk to businesses, about relocating, expanding, some of the things they talk about are the recreation facilities, their ability to use the finest, recreation center
definitely.
In Northeast Ohio.
Yeah.
So that their employees can take advantage of being located in Solon and using the rec center. The other thing that they talk about is how we've infused arts into the community. And it's become such a focus, I guess, of Solon, and how not only does it affect residents and help residents and families, but it's become a tool for business development. And at Peggy, and we all use it to be able to attract the business community for arts. We have obviously a vibrant dance studio. We have shows. We have theaters that are coming on. We have the Solon Philharmonic, which is in its fifth year and has had amazing concerts. They had a show just recently with Phil Dirt and the Dozers.
Was
the Beach Boys tribute, and it really showcased not only the Philharmonic Orchestra, but the infusion of rock. We had, even though it was, we had to move it from outside to inside, we had almost a full house in the high school auditorium. Mm-hmm. If you know the art scene in Northeastern Ohio, we're on the map. Not only are we on the map in terms of our programs, productions, the thousands of students that use our art center, but now folks from Northeastern Ohio are coming to Solon for these shows and for these exhibits and to get a taste of arts and culture in Solon. And that doesn't just help the art center, it helps our local businesses.
Right.
Because they buy lunch, and they buy gas, and they go to the convenience store, and it's wonderful infusion. We've really become a destination place for arts and culture throughout Northeastern Ohio.
And who would have ever dreamed 10 years ago that
the
program would expand to the point that you had to go rent property so you could keep the programs going? It just turned out to be one of those jewels that nobody really gave a lot of thought to originally, and then it really turned into something.
And it takes a visionary. Mm-hmm. And we found it in Karen Prosser. Mm-hmm. I mean, Karen created this. We fund it, and we go along with it, and we make sure that it's properly run and it's properly funded, and that the marketing's done. But Karen provided the vision for the Art Center.
Karen and her team are very high energetic people. I know that. It's fun to talk to them and watch them in action. We're towards the end of the month of July. Home days, car crews. We're going to have a home days. Sounds like it's getting off the ground.
Yeah, that's the one. I think it's the highlight of our summer. It's a 4-day festival. It's for families. It's for kids. It's for those of us that still think of ourselves as kids. And it's just 4 days of fun. Thursday, we kick it off with the senior spaghetti dinner at the rec, and that's just what a fun event. We have so much fun. We serve and great spaghetti, great food. Saturday morning is the Kiwanis pancake breakfast, and that's another wonderful event, great food at the rec center.
Rec center, okay. Yeah, that one will be at the rec center.
It's at the rec center. We have the car cruise, and that's really, last year I was just amazed at how many people came out for the cruise.
Ports Parkway was lined with cars.
It was wonderful.
And it was a very hot day, I remember that.
Yes, but it was absolutely wonderful. And not only did a lot of people came from outside of Solon for the car cruise, and they stayed for home days, stayed well into the evening. So that was a great, great partnership that we've had. We have great music. Every night is a new band, and a lot of times it's local band. The food is great. The rides are tremendous. We have a lot of booths of our local clubs, our local businesses. So really, we encourage everyone to patronize those. And then the highlight really is Sunday's parade. At 1 o'clock, we kick off from Arthur Road School. We have, I don't know, Coach, you want to quote me, but about 170-some entrants into...
So it's got to be one of the biggest ones we've ever had.
One of the biggest parades in Northeastern Ohio. And we invite everyone, all the community groups come out, the baseball teams, the bands, you name it. It's filled, and it's such a fun day. It's lined with kids. We all buy our candy to make sure there's enough candy to go around, and it's usually very hot, so it's a fun opportunity for the community to get together, and then we end it with fireworks Sunday evening too. But it's a great way for the community to come together. It's a social event. We hope everyone comes out, brings your family, and just enjoy and really celebrate the great thing we have going in our community.
It's just once in a while it's okay to have fun.
Absolutely.
And this is a time when you're definitely going to have fun. Ed, we need to kind of wrap this up.
Sure.
Looking into the future, what do you think Solon's challenges will be in the next 3 to 5 years? Money will always be a challenge. We know that. What are the things that we seem to be a very vibrant community, growing, we're a quality community. What challenges do you see us getting into in the next few years?
You know, I think it's always is to ensure the viability of our business community. I think that's critical, and I think you do that. One is you keep Peggy Weil-Dorfman,
okay.
and you make sure, because Peggy has a hand in, we have 800 business entities. I don't think people even realize.
I didn't even know it was that many.
Yeah, and some are obviously very small, but and some are very large, but we're concerned about the one-person shop, just as we're concerned about Nestle's and Swagelok and our large corporate entities. And you do that by ensuring that they get what they need. There's an open door policy in terms of communication, that they have the ability to grow, to expand. You want to make sure that they see Solon as a partner in everything that they do, in terms of green space, and we address the traffic concerns that they may have. And all of those various issues. So I think that's a critical priority. I think planning, the planning agenda is going to be, upfront. We need to provide for, somewhat of a sustainable model of planning. Like this project, looking at the architecture, the Western Reserve architecture, that it's not a cookie cutter type of plan, but every building is going to look a little different with different heights and different shapes. Green space. Green space is critical because not only is it look nice for the community, but it's good for our stormwater system and our stormwater management. When we less asphalt, more green space. So I think that's something that we're going to look at in everything, that we do. Redeveloping old shopping centers, redeveloping old buildings are key, because that brings in people, that brings in other businesses. Development breeds development.
Yes.
When there's nothing going on, you don't find other developers, whether it's locally or nationally, looking at Solon, Ohio. When you have a Echo Real Estate Group doing a major redevelopment project, other people start to take a look. That's what developers look at. That's what banks look at. And so it starts to, the stars start to align. And so I think those are going to be several of the things we're going to look at, and also keep a very close eye on our residential housing stock to make sure that it's safe. Property values stay, consistently where they are, and we don't lose a lot of property values. We need to make sure that both the exterior and the interior, are safe, and make sure that the streets, our communities, are something that people want to stay living in, even when your kids are grown. To make sure people, want to stay on our streets. So our housing stock is critical for the viability and well-being of our community.
Well, sounds good. As always, I'd just like to end the program reminding people that we want to be safe. Please follow the speed limits and stop at stop signs. Thank God we did not have some of the problems in terms of people being killed in other communities. We had a very safe community. We want to keep it that way. As you said earlier, we have an excellent fire and police department. But I also admire the people of Solon for using their good common sense and trying to be safe. And so we want to keep it that way. Certainly would like to avoid any tragedies, that's
absolutely
for sure. So, Ed, thanks a million for coming today and spending some time with us.
Too.
Covered a lot of ground. We got a lot of things done. We look forward to doing this again in the near future. And, like I said, once again, thanks for joining us.
My pleasure.
My name is Terry Dean, and this was another edition of Solon Speaks.